As I walk through the valley where I harvest my grain, I take a look at my wife and realize she's very plain. But that's just perfect for an Amish like me. You know I shun fancy things like electricity.
What would a sustainable world look like? Some kind of primitive agricultural society, or some kind of nature-centered paradise that never existed except in movies? As cool as it looks. Trying to get Americans to look squarely at the realities of energy and environment has been a thankless task, first attempted by Jimmy Carter.
Tonight I want to have an unpleasant talk with you.
Uh-oh.
About a problem that's unprecedented in our history. With the exception of preventing war, this is the greatest challenge that our country will face during our lifetime. The energy crisis has not yet overwhelmed us, but it will if we do not act quickly.
It was a tough sell to a younger generation, traumatized by Vietnam and Watergate, who for the moment seemed to just want to tune out, chill out, and turn off.
Hey man, am I driving okay?
I think we're parked, man.
For an older generation, the idea of energy conservation evoked memories of the Depression era. A nation struggling to throw off rural poverty and unemployment looked to electrification and grand initiatives by government and industry to pull the country into a modern world. Slogans like less is more and small is beautiful made no sense to a generation raised to believe bigger was better and biggest was best.
Uncle Sam took the challenge in the year of 33. Along Columbia, you can ramble to the sea, but the river, while you ramble, you can do some work for me.
Men and materials we had, factories we could build. But America desperately lacked one vital element, electricity. Electric power, the essential ingredients of aluminum and magnesium, the key to electrochemicals and shipbuilding.
Big spending on infrastructure and industry touched off a boom, and perpetual expansion seemed the only way to guarantee prosperity. In a time of global war, science and technology were vastly accelerated and brought to a terrifying new peak. The advent of nuclear energy seemed to confirm technology as a source of infinite power and possibilities. The scientists and engineers who understood it seemed as something more than mere mortals.
Here with my right.
They had truly stolen fire from the gods.
It is yours.
The atomic fire is an almost endless source of heat. We can use it in power stations for producing electricity. Electric power of our modern civilization.
But a generational change was brewing. The 60s saw not just a social revolution, but a scientific one as well that gave us powerful new perspectives on our planet and an awareness of its limits. There arose a well-organized, focused, and politically active movement to question the idea that unlimited growth was necessary, or even possible. In 1976, a young physicist named Amory Lovins, then working with the environmental group Friends of the Earth, published an influential article in the journal Foreign Affairs. Lovins analyzed the high-energy growth curves that were conventional wisdom at the time, and argued that economics no longer favored infinite growth of fossil and nuclear power, but rather leveling off as the society learned to better use energy and adopt what he called soft technologies, those based on renewable and sustainable resources like sun and wind. During the Carter years, funding for renewable energy technology soared. Carter was an engineer himself and concerned about the limitations of a society dependent on outside sources of energy. In a dramatic demonstration, Carter ordered that solar panels be erected on the White House roof as a working symbol of the emerging policy supporting sustainable, homegrown energy.
In the year 2000, the solar water heater behind me, which is being dedicated today, will still be here, supplying cheap, efficient energy. A generation from now, this solar heater can either be a curiosity, a museum piece, an example of a road not taken, or it can be just a small part of one of the greatest and most exciting adventures ever undertaken by the American people.
But Carter was not reelected, and the succeeding administration cut renewable energy funding. The new administration decided that renewable energy and efficiency were not a priority, that the way to supply energy was by ripping it from the ground, drilling under the sea, or exploring for it in faraway lands. For a time, the strategy seemed to work. And anyway, what could possibly go wrong? But all that was far in the future. For Amory Lovins and thousands of others who saw another way, it was time to get to work, researching and advocating a new road, a technology based on the idea that future generations matter. Lovins foresaw that energy consumption would be substantially lower than the mainstream predictions, not because it was environmentally desirable, but because saving energy was so much cheaper than buying or generating it, and the real world was beginning to bear him out. Since the end of World War II, data showed that energy use and GDP tracked each other very closely, leading a generation to believe you could not have one without the other. But in 1973, that changed abruptly.
This is NBC Nightly News, Wednesday, October 17th. Reported by John Chancellor.
Good evening. The Middle East war produced developments all over the world today. The oil-producing countries of the Arab world decided to use their oil as a political weapon.
With the sudden price jumps of the 1970s, energy growth flattened out. The economy stuttered and then resumed growth. But energy use no longer tracked with economic production, and the amount of energy used to produce a dollar of GDP has been steadily falling ever since. Over time, Lovins has been proven right. By the end of the 20th century, actual energy use has trended very close to his 1976 projection. The myth that a modern society can grow only by steadily increasing energy production has been giving away to an idea of a renewably powered, sustainable society. It's a concept that Lovins continues to develop and spread.
Imagine fuel without fear. No climate change. No oil spills, dead coal miners, dirty air, devastated land, lost wildlife. No energy poverty, no oil-fed wars, tyrannies, terrorists, no leaking nuclear wastes or spreading nuclear weapons, nothing to run out, nothing to cut off, nothing to worry about, just energy abundance, benign and affordable for all, forever. We claim to have an advanced industrial economy, and yet it is run on primeval swamp goo and dinosaur poop. Surely there must be some more modern way to do it.
Climate protection is not costly, it's profitable. It's cheaper to save fuel than to buy fuel. Somehow the economic theorists got the sign wrong, so we've been arguing about cost, burden, and sacrifice when we should be talking about profits, jobs, and competitive advantage.
So the notion that using energy smarter means we have to move back to some pre-industrial state has been shown to be primitive. In fact, continuing shifts in thinking about energy are making ever greater impacts on electricity use. And now even Exxon projects that gasoline consumption in the United States has peaked.
You've heard of peak oil? We may have hit peak gas stations. Believe it or not, there are 11% fewer gas stations in the U.S. today than there were a little over a decade ago. Americans are commuting less, driving more fuel-efficient cars, and taking more public transportation. Now the federal government is mandating even more fuel efficiency, so more and more gas stations are shutting down.
Analysts at Deutsche Bank agree, saying it's not so much that oil will run out, as that the impact of electrical and hybrid vehicles will be greater and happen faster than most observers currently believe.
Someone asked me where to look for an electric vehicle. What would I tell them? Ford. Yep. Ford.
A perfect example of leading-edge thinking is the Dow Chemical Company, which set goals for energy efficiency in 1994 and has steadily reduced its total greenhouse gas emissions during that time, adding $9 billion in savings to its bottom line.
You're talking dough,
bread,
Benjamins,
scratch, greenbacks, moolah, cheddar, simoleons.
For $1 billion spent on building a coal plant, we can create about 870 jobs. For solar energy, about 1,900 for the same $1 billion. Wind energy can create 3,300 if you manufacture the turbines locally, but $1 billion spent on energy efficiency can create 7,000 jobs. For an economy struggling to create new jobs, energy efficiency offers one of the fastest and most effective solutions. Whereas jobs building power plants can only help one community for a short time, promoting energy efficiency creates jobs in every community, rural and urban. Jobs that are high-tech and high-pay, as well as entry-level jobs for anyone that can dig a hole, swing a hammer, or bend metal. There's far more to talk about than I can fit in a single video, so I'll be returning to this topic in a part two. We're managing our energy better every year because it makes sense to do so. How much faster could the transition occur if we had policymakers who actually understood that we didn't leave the Stone Age because we ran out of stones?
Hey guys, Karen wants to take us for a ride in her SUV.
Dude, give us a minute.